Digital diplomacy is a phenomenon where international negotiations have entered the digital age, where diplomacy no longer takes place behind closed doors, as leaders tweet and send out messages on social media. This is Rebecca Eltler-Nissen, Professor of Political Science at the University of Copenhagen.
So, of course, the public was always important for world leaders. So that's not new. What's new is that the engagement with the public takes now place for the first time immediately, simultaneously, as you negotiate. So basically, you have a world leader that's kind of sitting with two faces, a backstage and a front stage at the same time. So when they negotiate around the table, they will have their smartphones or their iPads in front of them and tweet or update their profile, thinking about what would be the best one-liner as they are also negotiating, let's say, a peace agreement. And that's new.
It all begins around 2007, when President Obama becomes one of the first world leaders to actively use social media in foreign policy.
It basically means that when you negotiate, you no longer have that time and that space to carve out a compromise that you had before. You need to basically think of this space as always transparent, always open.
Traditionally, diplomacy rests on three pillars: time, space, and tact. And these pillars are basically what makes diplomacy work.
And all three pillars are being affected and shaped dramatically by the digital revolution. When leaders compete to be the first to go out on social media during negotiations, of course time gets pressured. And when you talk about space, well, that confidential space is being eroded very quickly if you have tweets and leaks from inside the negotiation room. And finally, tact. There are just limits to how polite you can be when you only have 140 characters. You have to remember that long and complicated language just doesn't fit social media. So you don't have that tactful language anymore. And that is fundamentally changing the way diplomacy plays out today.
The revolution of digital diplomacy has also opened foreign policy to the whole world and made it possible for everyone to follow these events from far away.
So what's really intriguing about this phenomenon is that it can both be a force of good. It can open our eyes to conflicts far away. It can make us more informed. And it can create more transparency in foreign policy, something we've wanted for hundreds of years. And on the other hand, it can be a force of evil. It can be a force of conflicts and rising misunderstandings and embarrassment. So one example of how the digital revolution really enters international relations was when the Pakistani foreign minister woke up one morning and saw online that Israel was threatening Pakistan with nuclear weapons. And he tweeted immediately and said, "Israel, remember, Pakistan is a nuclear power too." Had he just, you know, double-checked the story, he would have realized that the story was entirely fake. But at this point, the tweet from the Pakistani foreign minister was spread across and was seen as, you know, an example of Pakistan being under siege or being pressured. And that's just one example of how misinformation and disinformation also enters the diplomatic room. So the ultimate ambition of what I try to do is basically to try to develop a new theory of digital diplomacy, to understand what are the mechanisms that drive this process, what are the pitfalls, and what might be the solutions that would make it possible for diplomacy once again to deliver peaceful solutions.